welcome to the Well. We're so glad you're here. It's a beautiful day. Let's just stand and sing to God together, just in a time of worship.
Sunday, everybody. And before I start announcements, you might notice I have a little bit of a lisp. I got Invisalign recently, so don't feel awkward. If you kind of chuckle when I say some words, it's totally fine. I'm laughing at myself too. It's a little embarrassing. But here we are. It's still time to do announcements. So, first and foremost, we want to welcome you guys to the Well this morning. If you're watching online or if you're here in the room, welcome. And we would love for you just to take out your bulletin if you have it and the Connect card in there. Take some time to fill that out. Just put some of your information, whether you are a returning guest or you're a regular attender, or if it's your first time, we really, really want you to fill this out. And just fill up that information. Put a prayer request on there. We want to be in community with you, not only on Sundays, but throughout the week. And this Connect card is one of the main ways that we can do that. Second thing is that we have our Next Steps luncheon. And so if you are new to the church and you just want to meet our staff and hang out and just get to know a little bit about what we do, after second service at 12, from 12 to 1, we have lunch in the back room just across the way. In that youth room back there, we'll be having lunch for you. Come and join us. We would love to meet you and eat food with you. Food's always great. Can't get enough of that. And it's free food, so also the best kind of food. We also have our men's event coming up soon on August 20th. If you have any questions about that, go ahead and find Kevin after service, and he will get you all the information you need for that. But that is August 20th. And then we have some fun stuff to announce, as always, for our youth. So we have our all-nighter coming up here pretty soon in September. So we have a little bit of time. But if you know any 6th to 12th graders who just need to get involved in community, maybe they don't go to church, but you want to get them involved in a good community, the all-nighter is a really great way to start getting involved. It's not only our church, but a few churches around Modesto who are going to be a part of it. And so it'll be really, really fun, a really big community. We're going to do some fun stuff. We'll be at Funworks. We'll be at a church playing kickball. We'll be bowling. We'll be doing all those kinds of things. So just be praying for our kids, and also just be thinking about if you have the ability to possibly maybe volunteer. We'll talk about that a little bit later, but just be praying if maybe God is leading you just to spend some time with some kids for a night. We would love to have some volunteers, and we'll talk about that later on. Another thing we have a lot of announcements, so just bear with me here. Another thing is in the bulletin, if you have some youth, it does say that we only have our youth service during second service, but we will be doing youth during both services. Today it'll be with me in the back. After worship is over, we'll walk back to that youth room. So if you have any kids, 6th through 12th grade, send them back with me, and we'll have our own little Sunday service back there. And so both services, 9 a.m. and 10:30, we will be having our youth service. Another thing, and this is our last thing that we're talking about, is growth groups are coming up here pretty soon. They're going to be starting the week after Labor Day, and so keep your eyes out. And if you are a growth group leader, check your email, because you'll be getting an email soon just about updates of the way that we're going to do growth groups. And if you want to get connected in a growth group, just be keeping your ear out for signups and all of that. And so that's what's going on with us at the Well. There's a lot going on. And I'm just going to pray us into the rest of worship. Then we'll go on with the rest of our service. God, thank you so much for Sundays. Thank you so much for this community of people. Lord, I pray that those who might be attending for the first time, that they just feel welcomed and they feel at home. And Lord, those who are returning for multiple times and they've been here a lot, Lord, I pray that they just feel right at home here as well. Lord, I pray that you open our hearts for the message this morning. As we lean into worship, that we can just lean into your spirit and come with open hearts and open minds to see how you are working today and how we can step into your work in the world today. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
All right, with that, I invite you to stand as we continue in our time of worship. I'm just going to open it up with a brief word from the Bible. In 2 Timothy 1, it says, "Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and his grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. So with that, I just invite you to take part in the immortality and the life that is brought with the coming of Jesus.
We worship the King of the mountaintops. We worship the King of the ocean floor. Oh, the depths of your grace has saved me from the grave, and yet there's more. There's so much more. We will sing of the love that flows forever. We will sing of the grace that holds us dear. No, we won't be alone, for the love of Christ is shown. Your Spirit's here, your Spirit's here. So let us sing, let us shout. The whole world hears when praise abounds. Now there's nothing left to fear. God has come to save. Oh, we want to draw you near. When we sing your praise, we feel your Spirit here. Yeah. Death has died today. Now there's nothing left to fear. God has come to save. Oh, we want to draw you near when we sing your praise. We feel your Spirit here. So let us sing. Let us sing. Let us shout. The whole world hears when praise abounds. We are your voice. We are your
questioned it all, still you remain.
We thank you for everything you've done for us, God. When we had nothing but sin and death and struggle in our life, God, you came down even though you were sinless and you didn't have to face death. God, you chose to, and you chose to walk among us and show us the life that we could have with you. God, just give us Jesus and just bring us ever closer to you through the work of your Spirit. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. I pray you've had a good week. And if you haven't, I pray that God meets you right where you're at. I pray that you remember this week that God is in control and he cares for you and he loves you. And I know some of you are going, why is Kevin here? Tim just came back last week. And I know that's a question. And so the answer that I have for that is, and this is a statement from the well and the well board. So he was back this week, but the realization came that he needs some time to take care of his health. So the wells offered him an extended time for rest and healing. And at this time, we're asking everyone to honor him by helping to protect his time, his family, and his privacy. So as hard as that may be to hear in this moment, we're going to pray for our friend. We're going to pray for our pastor. And so I just encourage you, whether you're online, whether you're here, and this is your church, or you're even a guest and going, man, this is a time of that we need to pray. So that's what we're going to do. God, I come to you this morning, and in the midst of everything, God, times come when it's uncomfortable or awkward or we don't know what to do. And the truth is, every single one of us in this room needs you. Every single one of us in this room needs grace and love. And God, I pray that this morning, as we offer prayers to you for our friend and our pastor, God, that you let healing be the thing that comes the most, and you just let it be a time of refreshing and a time of encouraging and a time of building up. And I thank you for just this place and this church and the way that we can be real and honest with you, first and foremost, but honest with each other. And God, it's an amazing place, and I thank you for that. And I pray that as we progress forward and just let our hearts be for you first and foremost and for our pastor. And God, the encouragement that comes when hiccups come, it's amazing to look back as we process through stuff. God, I thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen. And man, I've really been struggling with this word normal, because I'm not normal in any way, and I don't think any of us are normal. But I've really been thinking, because, you know, the world goes, oh, we're going to get back to normal at some point. Oh, we'll never get back to normal. And so, this time of year for us in youth, and for a lot of you teachers, there's some normalcy to schedule. There's some normalcy to life that kind of like eases in. And as we really start thinking about normal, I've been asking, what is normal? What is normal? Really, what's normal, or what normal do I want to live in? What do I want to be normal for my life? And I hope through today we realize there's no right answer to normal at times, and at other times there is. So normal is this. Normal is conforming to a standard, the usual, or what's expected. So as I look around, I try to go, I don't see any normal people at all. I'm trying my best, but I'm just kidding. We all have weirdness about us, or we have differing opinions or differing views, and we can let that be kind of a weird thing for us. And I had a friend this week tell me, everyone's normal is different. And I was like, I wasn't going there, but that's so encouraging, if we're honest, that it just lets you go, my normal is okay. This is who I am. This is who God has made me to be. Okay, this is going to be okay. And if we look at the 12 disciples, there were 12 different normals and 12 different views and 12 different worlds that they all lived close. But who they related to and the things that reflected from them were different for the 12. And so as we look at that, as they came together, love and grace led as they followed Jesus on a crazy journey. And my hope with us is, as we start talking about normalcy and going, well, we're disciples of Christ, and if you're not a disciple of Christ, I pray that you become one. And I pray that you begin to understand, and maybe it's through this message today, that God loves you above everything, and that he gives grace for our sin, and he gives grace for so much in our lives. But the thing that I was looking at is, you look at the 12 disciples, and for what they were doing and how they were following the world and the culture they lived in, there was not a lot of conforming to a standard. There was not a lot of usual activity. There was not a lot of expected activity when they followed Jesus. They had questions all the time for him. Why are we doing this? What are you doing there? Like, God, what, this doesn't make sense right now. Until it did, until they saw him prove who he was, and all of that came together. And so today, maybe this is a good question, is what are you seeking today? And I don't know if you've ever really thought that as you walk into church, but everyone who walks into a church is seeking something. And some of us are seeking truth. Some of us are seeking encouragement. Some of us, it's acceptance or community or service or forgiveness or repentance. Some of us don't even know what we're seeking. We're just like, I just felt like I need to go. I feel like my whole life I need to be in church. I don't understand it. But we're seeking something, you see. Maybe we're seeking normal. Maybe others of us are like, I don't want anything to do with normal. But we're seeking. And you see, the amazing thing about church and community and what seeking does for us is it draws us together, and it brings us closer together whenever we all look at each other and go, okay, I see where you're seeking, but I'm seeking this, and you know what? Maybe this week I'm seeking repentance, and maybe this week you're just seeking encouragement. And as we talk about our story and our life, our own normals can come together and bring us closer together as friends, as church members, as people just enjoying time together, right? And as we let that bring us together, could you imagine what the church would do? It would do what the disciples did. It would go and take the gospel as far as we possibly can. I say it a lot when I do announcements. We are a church that opens the Word of God, and we read Scripture, and we believe it's true, and we base our lives off of that. If we don't, we might as well just go start a social club, and we could have a lot of fun. I say it a lot. We could do whatever we want outside of Scripture if we don't want to do a church. But we're here for church, and we're here to let this be what leads us. And what happens when we're not seeking, or what happens when we're not really focused on what we should be? And we're going to hear in a story today that drift happens, that our focus begins to change. And some of us, and this may be harsh to hear sitting in a church, some of us, that drift or the distractions in our life never let us truly accept Christ. Never let us, we want and we're seeking, but we're like, I'm not going to conform to their ways. I'm not going to do what that church does or those church people. Or maybe you're online and you're like, I don't even know why I'm here today. And you're going like, I'm not going to be like that guy. That doesn't make sense. How many people do we know that happens to? My prayer for you this morning is you just let God lead. I've been telling more and more people over the last few months, just work on a relationship with Jesus. Read his word. Pray. Let God work in that. Don't worry about Christians, because if people rely on us, what's going to happen? At some point, we're going to fail them. But let's look into this, right? And maybe you've heard this story before, and actually I spoke on this same story in a little different direction a couple years ago, and it's David, King David. After, you know, if you don't know who David is in the Bible, David, he became king after Saul died. Saul was the first king of Israel. And David had been chosen, and he was coming up through the lines, and David kills Goliath, and now he's earning favor, and he's brought into the kingdom, and he's doing extremely well, so well that Saul gets jealous of him and tries to kill him. The biblical account is so crazy and wild to read. I encourage you to read it. First and Second Samuel is just full of this story, and you're like, what is happening? Saul tries to kill him with a javelin inside of his throne room. And so Saul ends up pursuing him and trying to kill him, and David has to flee, and David is running. He's still leading armies. He's still doing the king's work, and he's still fighting battles for the king, but the king is pursuing him because the king wants to kill him because he's so jealous. And along the way, David's picking up some treasures. And if you know the story, it's like, oh, well, we just defeated them. I'll take that king's wife, and now she'll be my wife. And this happens a couple times in David's life. And so he has a few wives before he's even king. And if we look at the biblical account of what we're supposed to do with wives, well, kings are different. Kings can do whatever they want, right? No. Deuteronomy 17:7 says, the king must not take many wives for himself because they will turn his heart away from the Lord. And he must not accumulate large amounts of wealth in silver and gold for himself. Now, if you're a chauvinist, you're like, I told you, women ruin everything. One's enough. One's more than... I'm just joking. I'm just joking. Man, women make our life so much better, guys. Trust me. But what God is saying is one is more than enough, and you should only have one. And that's biblical marriage, is a man and a woman, a husband and a wife, and you have one, and lead the kingdom with that and watch what happens. But no biblical kings did that. And so there's red flags popping up. David's on this journey and he's out in the middle of the wilderness and they're battling and he's tired and he gets weary. And you got to think, yes, he has God and he knows God and everything he's doing, he believes for God. But what happens as you get into this? Does that sound like any of you getting tired or weary or lonely or struggling through where you're at and distractions start to come in? And so you see, David is not just getting these wives because he's lonely. He's getting these wives from political power to show who he is. And as these red flags start to pop up, Saul passes away. He gets killed in battle with Jonathan, David's best friend. And David takes the kingdom and he ends up, there's a few battles you can read through there, and we don't have time to go through all of them today, but they ended up, he gets to a place where now he's taking control over Jerusalem and he's in the kingdom, and his army, who he's the leader of his army, is out battling the Ammonites. But David didn't go. There's some more red flags. What's happening in David's life? He's went from pursuing and doing everything that he believes God has called him to do to now leading in an authority role of the way that he thinks he should lead. And so here's where we pick this story up, and it's in 2 Samuel 12, I believe we're in.
Yeah.
11, 2 to 5 is what we're going to read first. Late one afternoon after his midday rest, David got out of bed and was walking on the roof of the palace. And he looked over the city and he noticed a woman of unusual beauty taking a bath. He sent someone to find out who she was, and he was told she's Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, and the wife of Uriah the Hittite. And right there, there's a huge red flag. Because they know whose wife she is, and they know whose daughter she is. But David doesn't care. Because David is not in the right mindset in this time. He's the king, and he's believing all the hype about him. You see all the hype that they would sing? Saul killed his thousands. David killed his 10,000s. He begins to believe the hype, and no one's going to tell me what to do. And I don't know because I wasn't there, but you can start to see as sin enters our lives, and we are dealing with this stuff, we stop checking with the people around us. And that's what David's doing. He sends his messengers to get her. And she came to the palace and he slept with her. It says she has just completed the purification rites after her menstrual period. And then she returned home. And later, when Bathsheba discovered that she was pregnant, she sent a message to David saying, "I'm pregnant." Immediately, the results of his sin are going to become evident to people, right? The closest of the close maybe know, oh no, Bathsheba, David's bringing these women in. And what's really happening in David's life? What is he doing? And you see, the issue begins here in this story because David's just at home when he should be out fulfilling his purpose as a leader and as a king and ruling and helping his armies win. But he's not. How many times in our lives have you ever just fell into sin when you're right on purpose, when you're out serving the community, when you're giving food to people who need food? It's hard to lose purpose and to drift into sin when you're doing those things. So we see David here, and he's messed up. And I remember reading this book, and maybe you've read it. It's by Francis Chan. It's called Crazy Love. And he tells a story in this book about his mother-in-law. And the family had gone to the movies, and they were sitting in the movie theater, and she's like uncomfortable. And she tells him, "You need to take me home right now." And he's like, "What? We're at the theater, right? We're watching the movie." And she's like, "No, I need to go home right now." And so he does, and as he's taking her home, she's like, "I don't want to be here when Jesus comes back. I don't want Jesus to find me just sitting in the movie theater watching a movie." Okay, we can go, she's crazy and way too extreme. Maybe she is. But her mindset was, I want to be doing the kingdom work. I want to be doing what God has called me to do as much as I possibly can. I'm not saying don't go to the movies. I hope you don't hear that today. The story in this, though, is she was a person who, he also talks about, right next to her bed, there were two worn spots. where she would be on her knees praying so much in her room that it wore, like it wore the carpet, not just smashed from furniture being there, like wore holes in the carpet. You see, David wasn't focused on his purpose. Someone like that is focused on their purpose. Prayer works, and she's wanting to be connected with God as much as she can, and her focus was all about doing what God would have her do. Maybe her normal is way crazier than most of our normals, right? But some people are just prayer warriors, and that's their life, and she would rather be on her knees praying for God and praying for their family and praying for the world than in the movie theater. And there's nothing wrong with that, if we're being honest. If that's what she feels her call is, to pray like that. So as we pick up in the story, now that she's pregnant, people are going to start realizing that she's pregnant. So what's David going to do? He's going to try to cover up his sin. And most of us have heard this story, right? David sends word to Joab, send me Uriah the Hittite. So Joab sent him to David. When Uriah arrived, and Uriah is out fighting the battle where David should be, but he calls him back. Uriah arrived. David asked him how Joab and the army were getting along and how the war was progressing. Then he told Uriah, go home and relax. David even sent a gift to Uriah after he had left the palace, but Uriah did not go home. He slept that night at the palace entrance with the palace's guard. Now, our sin may not be adultery and having a baby out of wedlock and all of these things. Our sin may be something very, very simple, but I think as we're talking through this message, we can go, I remember when I lied because I did this. I remember when I redirected people because I didn't want them to see what my sin was. And if we're careful, we'll get caught up on that stuff. But let's look and see. The reason that I think all of these, like the layers of the sin here, are in the Bible so we can see what the results of actions happen, right? Uriah doesn't go home. Uriah stays, and he actually sleeps right outside of the palace door because he's like, I'm not going to go do that, right? What's David's response? Why didn't you go home to be with your wife? Uriah's purpose was for his soldiers, was for the kingdom, was believing he was doing what was right by God. And David's trying to use him as a pawn to cover up his own mistakes. Uriah replies to David. He says, the ark of the armies of Israel and Judah are living in tents, and Joab and my master's men are camping in the open fields. How could I go home to wine and dine and sleep with my wife? I swear I would never do such a thing. Now, wining and dining and sleeping with your wife isn't a problem, okay? That's not the problem. The problem is that's not where he's supposed to be in that time. And he's being pulled apart, and the king's going, no, just go. It's fine. But you had David, again, trying to cover his tracks, and Uriah's going, no. I know my purpose. I know what I should be doing. I know where I'm at. God, I know exactly what you've called me to do. And so then David in verse 12 says, stay here today, and tomorrow you may return to the army. So Uriah stayed in Jerusalem that day and the next, and then David invited him to dinner and got him drunk. But even then, he couldn't get Uriah to go home with his wife. Again, he slept at the palace's entrance with the king's palace guard. What depths will we go through to cover up our sin? Credit card bill comes and you're throwing it in the fireplace. I can't let anyone see this. For students, right? They have 17 social medias because they don't want anyone to know exactly what they're doing at any moment in time. We call them Finstas, fake Instagrams for kids. Easy ways to be able to do what you want to do and not let the people who would call you out see what you're doing in life. And David right here, he's trying to cover up his mistakes. He's trying to cover up his past. All of his intentions, all of these things were red flags. And I don't know, but for us, what are the red flags for us when we're walking into sin, right? You're doing something and you get a random text and you're like, how do you know I'm not where I'm supposed to be right now? You're looking at something on your phone you shouldn't be looking at, or you're online arguing with people online just because you got nothing better to do, and you're like, and then out of the blue, a friend sends you a notification, be like, hey, what's up? Oh my goodness. The Bible app sends you the verse of the day, and you're like, all right, God. All right, okay, God, fine. All right. It happens, right? It happens. And so this is what the Holy Spirit does. If you're a Christian and you've accepted Christ as your personal Savior and your faith is in Jesus, the Holy Spirit gives us this thing. It's called the check heart light. I don't know if you know that or not. In the cartoons when you were kids, you would see the devil on one shoulder and the angel on the other, and it was like, who am I going to follow today, right? That's real life, folks. We live with spiritual warfare happening all around us. It's awkward to talk about, and it's weird, and I don't understand all of it, but I know this. I know the enemy hates me. And I know that whenever I get into sin, if I'm not careful, this is exactly what I'll do. If I don't think of that first engine light and deal with it and mess with it and try to find out why does this person keep texting me? Maybe I just need to call them and hear what they have to say and then go, okay, God, I see what you're doing. Okay, God. God, I'm so sorry. But David didn't do that. He just kept trying to like roll the snowball downhill, and it's just gaining steam and it's getting bigger and bigger and it's wreaking havoc all the way down the hill. And in verse 14, we pick up, so the next morning, David wrote a letter to Joab to give to Uriah to deliver. The letter instructed Joab, station Uriah on the front lines where the battle is fiercest, then pull back so that he will be killed. So Joab assigned Uriah to a spot close to the city wall where he knew the enemy's strongest men were fighting. And when the enemy soldiers came out of the city to fight, Uriah the Hittite was killed along with several other Israelite soldiers. But what about the soldiers on the other side of the battle? That for this day, maybe they weren't going to fight that day. Like you have the impact of this one sin just getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and the effects getting worse and worse and worse. And you just have to look how far sin can take us. And this is why I don't even have this in my notes, but this is why Jesus had to literally die on a cross to get our attention. To go, you have to see the effects of your sin. You have to see what's happening. And sometimes we don't even think about the effects, right? Any of you know what a narcissist is? Not me. No, I'm not a narcissist. So this week, I've been dealing with some stuff. Can I be real with you this morning? And I had to look up, am I a cynic this week? I don't think I am. There's some cynicism that lives inside of here. I can be so passive aggressive. Or I can use sarcasm to get a point when I don't need to. And I've been having to go, God, okay. And I've talked to some of my friends from my past who know me and can go, Kevin, you're they use words like, I know we don't like to hear the word stupid in church, but sometimes it's the only way to describe your actions. And in my past, they would go, Kevin, you're being stupid right now. Just look around. Consider everyone that's involved in your story right now. Those are the things that we have to let God turn the check your heart light on. I'm working on a truck right now, and every time I fix one thing, I start it, and I start to drive, ding, another light goes off, and I'm like, God, is this my life? I'm going to be like trying to fix this truck forever. What is it? But when you think about it, sometimes that's us. We're like, oh, can I just clear the codes real quick? If you get a tool, you know, you can just clear the codes, and they may clear for a while. You get 5 miles, 20 miles, 100 miles down the road, ding, the code's right back. What's happening in your heart? What needs to be addressed today? In verse 26, when Uriah's wife heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. When the period of mourning was over, David sent for her and brought her to the palace, and she became one of his wives. Then she gave birth to a son, but the Lord was displeased with what David had done. And here's where we get kind of real, because I know the script of my life. And I could look at the list of things and go, I know where the Lord was displeased. 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 But the truth is, grace on the cross covers that. And if I'm not careful, I just look at all the times that I messed up, and that becomes my story. That becomes my normal, just living in the past, thinking, well, I'm no good, I'm worthless, nobody could ever trust me because of these things. And I hope that you realize, once you pray for forgiveness and repent, it goes away. That's the beauty of unconditional love. That's the beauty of the love that we have in God. So the forgiveness is there, but the ripple effects continue. The damage that's done sometimes from what we're doing and how we're living and where we go if we're not careful. So where does this story go? Is it just, well, David just ruins the rest of his life and lives in sin? If you've ever watched King George and the Rubber Ducky by VeggieTales, just go home and YouTube it. You will have a ton of fun for about 26 minutes. It's pretty awesome. So much fun. But 2 Samuel 12:1-2 says this. So the Lord sent Nathan the prophet to tell David this story. There were two men in a certain town. One was rich and one was poor. The rich man owned a great many sheep and cattle. The poor man owned nothing but one little lamb that he had bought. He raised that one little lamb, and it grew up with his children. It ate from the man's own plate and drank from his cup. He cuddled it in his arms like a baby daughter. One day a guest arrived at the home of the rich man, but instead of killing an animal from his own flock or herd, he took the poor man's lamb and he killed it and he prepared it for his guest. Verse 5, David was furious. As surely as the Lord lives, he vowed, any man who would do such a thing deserves to die. He must repay four lambs to the poor man for the one he stole and for having no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are that man. Have you ever had a friend tell you, you are that man? Unfortunately, I have. Fortunately, they loved me enough to walk with me and hold my hand and care for me. The Lord, the God of Israel says, I anointed you king of Israel and saved you from the power of Saul. I gave you your master's house, his wives, and the kingdom of Israel and Judah. And if that had not been enough, I would have given you much, much more. You see, God promises to give us and cover all of our needs. And he's saying, David, I covered everything for you and it wasn't enough. I would have given you more. Why then have you despised the word of the Lord and done this horrible deed? For you have murdered Uriah the Hittite with the sword of the Ammonites and stole his wife. From this time on, your family will live by the sword because you have despised me by taking Uriah's wife to be your own. He's saying for the rest of your family's lives, they're going to have to battle. They're never going to have rest. They're going to have to fight and scratch and claw. And the sword is going to dictate what happens to your family. Now, parents, this is harsh, but this is true. Our kids look at us and our lives impact their lives. There's a trickle down. Now, I understand sometimes it's outside influences and they become friends with the wrong crowd and this, but we have to, we're called to reflect Jesus. And when we haven't done that, repent. Let your kids know, this is where I messed up. You don't have to go through every single story. Let your kids know you wish it had been different. I want to show you a new way. Work with your children. Don't let this be your story. Verse 11. This is what the Lord says. Because of what you have done, I will cause your household to rebel against you. I will give your wives to another man before your very eyes, and he will go to bed with them in public view. You did it secretly, but I will make this happen to you openly in the sight of all Israel. Could you imagine if they made a movie that portrayed this? How horrible it would look to see that happening on screen. Now, here's where my crazy mind, where my normal is different than some people's, is I'm going like, the Lord sent Nathan the prophet. He's like, are you serious, God? I don't want to go to David. We all know his anger. They just kill prophets anyways. He's like, oh my goodness. He's like dragging his feet the whole time. God, you better protect me. You better take care of me. Could you? Man, when you have to call a friend out, when you have to care for a friend, or you, or a friend comes to you to ask, it's not easy for either side, guys. But that's what we're called to do. The truth is, every one of us needs a Nathan in our lives. We must be willing to allow people to see our lives, to be close to us, to care for us, to actually honor God. One of the best things a friend can do for you in honoring God is to talk about your sin when you're in it, to be there for you, to love you through it. Just imagine how hard it was for Nathan. But God was with him. I mean, we talk about it all the time. I know there's not a single perfect person in this room. I know some of you are almost angelic, and you're like, not me, Kevin. Don't talk to me like that. But even you still need a Savior, right? We all need a Savior. As close as you are to perfect, as close as your perfection is, or as close as you want people to believe your perfection is. But here's the truth. When we're not pursuing our purpose, we let fade drift in. And it leads to a life of destruction if we don't have guardrails. Are any of you good at bowling? I was talking with my daughter yesterday, and she had gone bowling this week, and she goes, I had to put the bumpers up the whole time. I'm like, that's how I live my life. There's so many hilarious videos you could watch, but just imagine like the reflection of sin in our lives, like bumper, bumper. We're just going path after path. If the guardrails are there, it's okay. It's okay. Because those guardrails are going to keep us within purpose, within will, within what God would have us do with our lives. When we go, what's on the other side of that guardrail? I'll just take it down just a week, a day. Maybe this one. Just for a little while, it'll be all right. You know how hard it is to come back in? There's always forgiveness. There's always forgiveness in God. And here's what happened to David. You know, he didn't wake up one day going, you know what, I want to kill Uriah. I just want to kill one of my own men just to do it. It was a long list of smaller distractions, leaping over guardrail after guardrail after guardrail, not following God's word, having more wives than you're supposed to have, living in pride, living in anger, the things that we're not supposed to do. So the effects were not only the murder of Uriah and the others in the battle, the baby in the affair dies 7 days after it's born. And then more of his sons. And then within four generations, the whole kingdom is gone out of his family. There's no legacy left. We could look it up and go, oh, his son did what? Yeah, what was promised, his son did it. Drift happens. It's normal. We live in a broken world, but drift is not an excuse. God always has an out for our sin. If we realign our purpose, we will drift less. I promise that. The word promises that. Have fun in the middle of that road. And every now and then, if you need a bounce off of a guardrail, it's kind of fun. Really, I mean, I don't know about you, but just run straight into it. It bounce off to the other one. The rumble strips on the roads are there for a reason. And just think about your life like that. This is what happens when we let sin close. I was driving this morning on the way to church. And if you drive down Parker Road, it's right here, Briggsmore turns into Parker. As you're driving out, the road kind of dips down on the right-hand side. There's a company, and this company, it's a house. It's a guy who lives in his house, and he has this company, his garage or something. It's called Sierra Research Laboratories. Most of you are like, I never even heard of that. If you look it up on Google Maps, it's there. This guy, like, he has tons of bugs, and he like works on pesticides, and he's treating bugs, and he's working through all this stuff with anamorphs, and I'm like, this guy must be kind of weird. His normal's playing with bugs all the time. As I was praying this morning and driving to church, and I was kind of like just feeling uncomfortable with this whole message, I'm driving past that house, and it's tinted for termites. I'm like, that's what you get for playing with bugs, you weirdo, right? Like, man, when God wants to get a point across, he's going to get a point across. I was dying. It made me laugh. I was just like, okay, God, like, you are hilarious. For us. So, check out these sins. If they're close, don't make your life be tinted. Lust, sexual impurity, gluttony, food, or wanting better food, wanting to fill yourself more than everyone else, greed, and everything away from your purpose, desires of the flesh, sloth, doing what you're not supposed to do, taking your focus off of where you should be, wrath, have no self-control, anger, hatred lead your life, envy, wanting what others have, wanting to only the best for you at all cost. Pride, my stuff doesn't stink. He's not talking about your clothes. I know what's best. You see, all of the decisions, when we get into that stuff, they're either made by when our pride takes over, we don't think we're going to get in trouble, or we think that whatever we do, people are just going to go, yeah, sure, that's fine. I'm not going to say anything. Samuel 12:13, and here is the, I don't know what you think of David's life, but here is the most important moment in David's life in the whole Bible. Not him being called out as a little kid to be king, not him beating Goliath, not him becoming king. This is the most important statement that David could ever hear in his life. And in 12:13, then David confessed to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan replied, yes, but the Lord has forgiven you and you won't die for this sin. Death was coming, we're all gonna die. This is how you understand who people, whenever it says David was a man after God's own heart, this is what he's talking about. Being willing to repent, being willing to ask for forgiveness, being willing to lay your stuff down and work through it and process through it, and the effects are going to come. God never left David. He never left him. In that time, I don't know if this psalm was written in that exact time, but I could imagine David feeling like this. It's Psalm 32 that he wrote. It says, how joyful is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. How joyful is a person whom the Lord does not charge with iniquity and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones became brittle from my groaning all day. When you're living in sin, that's what it feels like. For night and day, your hand was heavy on me. My strength was drained as in the summer's heat. We all know what happens when the water dries up, the plants die, everything withers. He's saying my body felt like I was just shriveling away. And then Selah is kind of a refresh, or let's pause, or let's really soak this in. And then in verse 5, he says, then I acknowledged my sin to you, and you did not conceal my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. You see, he was a servant until he lost his way. He was doing what he believed God wanted him to do until he got a little tired and weary and was letting the effects of the world wear on him. He was letting that start to go, well, I deserve that. Let's just put this guardrail down, and I'll get a wife that I probably shouldn't take, but it'll be all right. And then not long later, he takes another wife, and then another wife, and then another wife. And maybe it's not wives for you. Maybe it's money. Maybe it's envy. Maybe it's just anger. I was reading a book this week called Undistracted, and in it, Bob Goff says, evil wants to distract us from expressing our gifts and keep us from doing what we're meant to do. You see, if we look at Jesus as normal and what was Jesus normal, evil reminded him of his purpose. He went to the Father being filled with the Spirit and never lost focus. He never sinned. He was a perfect example of what we should even be chasing after. You see, God is calling to all of us, do it my way, trust me, and watch what I can do. Do you believe that? You believe God's calling even you in this morning, even if you don't haven't put your faith in God yet? Do it my way, trust me, and watch what I can do. I'm going to challenge you guys to remember that and to say it this week. Do it my way. This is God speaking over you. Do it my way. Trust me. Watch what I can do. That's a mashup of a whole bunch of scripture. But if you read the Bible, this is what God is telling us to do. You see, David's normal was this. David's normal was sin. Maybe repent. Sin. I'm sorry. Sin. I'm sorry. Sin. I'm sorry. God never left David. My hope is that we take the reflection on us and go, okay, God, I don't want to live in sin, repent, sin, repent, sin, repent, sin, repent. Because you know what's happening while you're sinning and while you're repenting? Your purpose is not being accomplished. We're all going to sin. It's going to happen. My encouragement is that we start to see how we can remove the distractions and keep those guardrails up and really let God lead and focus. And so with that, I'm going to read Romans 12, 1 and 2 and really have us kind of like focus our mind on what this scripture means, not just for this morning in light of David's life, but in light of your life. And I'm saying your life as I'm talking about my life as well. And where are we at? And Bobby's going to come and he's going to play a little bit of music for us behind. And we don't typically do this at the well. We don't really have altar calls. We tell you if you need prayer. We have prayer partners. We do. If you see someone with a red badge that says need prayer, maybe just find them. But here's that verse. Romans 12, 1 and 2. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all that he's done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Do not copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. You see, worship leads to faith. What are you worshiping and how are you worshiping? And I say all of these words with a church that's growing and a church that's serving our community and a church that is loving. But there's times that we just need to refocus. There's times that there's been guardrails taken down and we just need to come back together and go, you know what, I need to repent of this. I need to pray. I need to let God be the lead in this. So I wrote this, and I'm going to have to basically read it to get the point across. Normal was conforming to a standard, usual or expected. But God tells us, live not as the world does. Jesus' normal was living not as the world did, was to live as God wanted him to live. How we get there becomes our normal. It becomes relatable, and healing becomes our normal. Our world needs healed of evil. Our world needs healed of hurt. Our world needs healed of shame and guilt. We are called to help everyone along that journey as we walk in our own. Let's worship God so that our faith grows. Let's focus on our purpose so lives are changed forever. God is for us. God is for the lost. God is for the hurting. We're a part of that restoration, so get prepared. Stop looking at the things in life that really don't matter. The things over those guardrails. Doesn't mean you can't have fun, you can't go to the movies. When we live in those guardrails, God changes your lives. So I'm going to pray, and whatever that means for you, if you need to kneel, if you need to find someone to pray with, if you just want to come and whatever that is this morning. I'm not trying to freak the newcomers out. We don't do this often, but just, man, there's a time sometimes you just go, God, I need to let it go this morning. And I don't know where you're at, but if that's you, ask for repentance and let it go this morning. I'm going to pray for us. God, we're a church because of you. We're in this room because of you. We're watching online because of you. And God, I pray that as you work in our lives, Lord, you remind us of the things that are outside the guardrails that we're working in right now. God, even this morning, I pray for the check engine lights in my life, that God, you let me work on those. You let me be reminded of what I need to do in repentance, or what I need to do in communicating with a friend or a confidant, God. For all of us, we have stuff. And sometimes, Lord, it's a moment like this when we let it go and say, God, you're bigger than all of this. You're bigger than everything we deal with, Lord. I pray this morning that as we let stuff go, or as we're just kind of refocused in where you would be moving us into, God, I pray that purpose is what just shines out of us. I pray that the world sees messed up people who are normal is just trusting you. Who are normal is just leaning into you, even in the ups and downs of the Christian walk, God. And I pray this morning for every person who's hurting or letting something go or just desiring a closer relationship with you. I pray that this church is that place of healing this morning, God, because of you and your power and just how you move in spirit. Thank you so much, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
With that, we're gonna close out with one last song, and this song is, let's not play yet, Keith. We're good. So I invite you to stand as we just continue to reflect on that. This song is called Yes, I Will, and it's just a call and a cry to say yes to God's will and God's working in your life. So if you feel the Spirit moving inside you from Kevin's message and the words that have been shared, then that's the purpose of this song. It's just a response to the movement of the Spirit in your life. All right, let's go. I count on one for me. The same God that never fails will not fail me. Won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name.
God that never fails will not fail me now.
that's our prayer for you this week, that you'll just continue to say yes to God as he's working and moving through you. So go on with your day. Have a great Sunday. Thank you for coming.